you're about to see is a real-life story, taken from the files of the police racket and bunco squads, business protective associations, and similar sources all over the country. It is intended to expose the confidence game, the carefully worked out frauds by which confidence men take more money each year from the American public than all the bank robbers and thugs with their violence. Racketeers will take advantage of any situation where they can make a quick dollar. Some rackets are involved with financial spoils only, while others prey on human emotions. I call this case the Homewreckers. It was after I had left my office to check the facts in another case that I...
John!
Dan Stevens.
Oh, am I glad to see you.
Well, I should hope so. You know, it seems like years since you ran off and got married and deserted all your old friends. How's your wife? Any children?
Lori, my wife, is getting a divorce.
Oh, that's surprising. I just saw Joe Daniels and he said that you two were getting along fine.
I'd like to talk to you. Can you spare a minute?
Well, sure. Come on upstairs to my office. Sit down, Dan. Ah, what's it all about?
Well, the divorce is about to go through.
So soon? Gee, I'm sorry, Dan.
So am I. I've got a good job. Things were going fine. Then Lori got this divorce bug. Now everything's all mixed up. Even the way we're being divorced.
What about the way you're being divorced?
Well, somehow it all seems wrong. I just don't trust the... Maybe I'd better give you the whole story. One night I came home late. Lori was waiting. Sorry I'm late, honey. I tried to phone you, but your line was busy.
I phoned you. Your office didn't answer.
I must have been trying to get you at the same time.
You must not have phoned from your office.
No, I phoned from around the corner.
Is that where you picked up this face powder?
It's probably dust or chalk.
Since when did they start sending chalk with perfume?
All right, so it's face powder. A girl accidentally upset her compact near my arm.
What girl?
An ordinary, everyday girl, my secretary.
Why did you lie about it?
I didn't want to create a problem, and you always make something out of nothing.
Oh, I do. I suppose it's nothing that you're 2 hours late for dinner. I think I deserve some explanation. Why did you work so long?
I have to hustle to keep solvent.
Dan, don't you love me anymore?
Lori, I love you very much. But lately you've become so jealous and suspicious. When you get that way, you can be the most exasperating female on the face of the earth.
I don't want to be like that, Dan. But when I don't know where you are, I begin to worry. And when you do come home with face powder on your coat, well, shouldn't I be surprised and upset?
Oh, look, sweetheart. You're the only girl for me. You ought to know that. I'm going to wash up.
All right, I'll put the food on the table.
No, don't bother. I grabbed a bite before I came home.
You did? Why didn't you tell me?
You didn't give me a chance.
Dan, come over and sit by me.
That's better.
Why don't we ever go to the Club Granada?
We can, anytime you want to. Why the Club Granada all of a sudden?
Just curious. Is it nice?
Pretty good. No different than a lot of other cocktail lounges.
Did you ever eat there?
Sure. I had a drink and a sandwich there this evening.
Alone?
Why, no, I took Helen along.
Helen Ward, your charming secretary. So that explains what kept you.
Well, what's wrong with that? She worked after hours to help me. It was only courtesy to stop for a cocktail and a bite to eat.
You drove her home, too, I suppose.
Of course, why not?
She's pretty. All the curves in the right places, or haven't you noticed?
Come to think of it, she is a nice-looking girl. Oh, now look, sweetheart, don't be like so many other wives. Just because Helen is attractive is no reason she shouldn't have a job. There just aren't enough homely secretaries to go around. Jealous women force their husbands to hire them as fast as they show up.
Oh, you're so smooth, Dan Stevens, and so convincing. She's pretty, and she likes cocktails, and she just loves to work late so you can drive her home. Do you think I'm blind?
No, Laurie. I just think you're being unreasonable and stupid.
Stupid, am I? Just because I won't believe your flimsy excuses?
Don't ever do that again, Laurie. Let that be the first and last time.
Don't you dare threaten me. I'm not afraid of you.
I meant it.
You struck me. You're not only a cheat, you're a coward.
Oh, I'm sick of this nonsense. I'm going out till you cool off and stop acting like a spoiled child.
Go on. Hurry. You mustn't keep Helen waiting. I was surprised when you phoned me to meet you here.
I had a reason, Helen. Did you mind coming?
No. Only your wife might not understand your secretary meeting you after business hours.
You can bank on that.
Tell me, doesn't your wife understand you? Or does she understand you too well? You love her, don't you?
Crazy about her. She's a wonderful girl in every way, except...
Yes?
Oh, I wish she wouldn't be so infernally jealous and suspicious. Well, you'd think I'd committed a crime just because I came home late tonight. I can't look at a girl or even speak pleasantly to her without causing a scene.
I might as well wear blinkers.
Maybe it's because she loves you so much and feels a lack of security. May I ask you something?
Sure, go ahead.
Do you take her in your arms often and tell her how much you care for her?
I guess so, about as much as any other husband.
Maybe that isn't enough for Laurie. Maybe she needs to be constantly assured.
Oh, waiter, two more of the same. Make that three.
Sit down, Laurie. I've been expecting you.
No, thank you. I prefer to stand.
Then I'll stand, too.
Polite, aren't we? I'm surprised at you, Miss Ward. Men must be hard to get.
I'm sorry, Mrs. Stevens.
Laurie, Helen is here at my invitation. And if I'm not mistaken, you urged me not to keep her waiting.
As if you needed an excuse. I'm aware this isn't just a coincidence.
Oh, come on, Laurie. Be your old self. Join us. I ordered a cocktail for you.
Please do, Mrs. Stevens.
Yes, thank you. I'll join you. So kind of you to invite me.
Laurie, I was hoping you wouldn't create a scene.
Weren't you expecting a little too much? How much do you think I can stand?
Laurie, listen to me.
There's nothing more to say. I intend to see a lawyer first thing in the morning and get a divorce as quickly as possible.
All right, if that's the way you want it, go right ahead. Come on, Helen, I'll drive you home.
I think you're making a big mistake, Mrs. Stevens.
I don't care what you think, Miss Ward. Goodbye, Mr. Stevens. Better luck with your new conquest.
Come on, Helen.
Give me a martini. Dry. Mrs. Stevens?
I'm sorry.
Oh, I realize that we haven't met Mrs. Stevens, but...
Well, I couldn't help overhearing the discussion you were having with your husband and his friend. Here, drink a little of this. It'll make you feel better.
Thank you. But I don't understand. Why are you...
Well, I realize that you've been through a very trying emotional experience, and I thought maybe you needed a little cheering up. I know when we have to face up to something like divorce that... Well, one needs a good friend to talk to.
I'm sorry, Mr.
Oh, Adams. Henry Adams.
Thank you, Mr. Adams, but I don't wish to discuss my personal affairs with a stranger.
Well, I'm hardly a stranger to anyone, Mrs. Stevens. I just wanted to be helpful.
Then you'll excuse me. I must go home.
Of course. May I see you to a cab?
Maple Street, please.
You're sure I can't be of any help, Mrs. Stevens?
Thank you, no, Mr. Adams. Good night.
Good night, Mrs. Stevens.
You can have the bathroom now.
Oh, Laurie, let's bury the hatchet. This thing has gone far enough.
Yes, Dan, it has gone far enough. And I'd appreciate it if you'd arrange to have your things picked up today. You better get dressed. You're late already.
And that was the breaking point. A fine young couple headed for unhappiness. Another marriage ending in separation. It happens all too often over fairly unimportant causes. People are sometimes inclined to act rashly after a quarrel, especially if they're in love and easily hurt.
Will you have lunch with me? I want to talk this thing over.
No, thank you. I don't want to talk over anything with you.
Laurie, listen to me.
Please not call me again. I don't want to talk to you.
I beg your pardon. Is this Mrs. Stevens?
Oh, excuse me. I thought... Yes, this is Mrs. Stevens.
I'm Sandra Adams, Mrs. Henry Adams. My husband met you last evening, and he thought it a good idea for me to call you. I looked your number up in the telephone book. He hopes you understand his motive in talking to you. You see, he's told me about your unhappy situation, and I wanted you to know that we'd both like to help. Divorce is an unhappy experience at best, but it's so much easier to bear when we can share the burden. And I think we can help you, Mrs. Stevens. Would you talk to my husband for a moment? He's right here.
I hope you'll forgive this call, Mrs. Stevens.
It's quite all right, Mr. Adams, but how can you help me? Are you a lawyer?
Yes, I am a lawyer. I specialize in divorce cases. Well, since you feel as you do, and your husband will undoubtedly do the same thing to you again, I suggest you make it a clean break. Why not come to my office and talk it over? Oh, I'm sure we can help you through this thing so that there'll be no fanfare, no nasty publicity. Fine. I'll see you at 3:00. Goodbye, Mrs. Stevens. Well, I think that's all the information I need from my out-of-state associate. At least I can't think of another thing. Now, you still have an opportunity to change your mind.
No, I want to go through with it.
All right.
How much money will you need?
Oh, about $200 to start. Of course, that covers the incidental expenses, the initial costs, like filing, securing of proxies, and that sort of thing.
Proxies? What do you mean by proxies?
Well, we need a resident to stand up for you in court.
You mean I won't have to go there?
Oh, no. We secure this divorce for you without you even establishing a personal residence.
Oh, I didn't realize that.
Oh, there's one more thing. I'll need your husband's signature to some papers. Where can I reach him?
His office is in the Williams building. How long will it take? For the divorce, I mean.
Oh, 4 to 6 weeks should see you a free woman. Well, that's all I need you for today, Mrs. Stevens. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Adams.
Thank you, Mr. Stevens. Now we can get rolling.
I wish I could have reached Laurie, but I guess if she signed the paper, she means to go through with it.
Well, women like the dramatic. You know, you have to give in to them before they give in to you. Sometimes you even have to let a woman divorce you so that she can have the thrill of letting you win her back.
But all this needless expense.
Well, any divorce is expensive. But in this case, we're saving time and inconvenience, plus the cost of travel and maintenance while establishing residence. Well, I've got to be running along, but I'll keep you informed of our progress. Good day, Mr. Stevens.
Good day. I came to get my things.
Of course. Nearly everything's packed, but you better check to be sure. Your bag's in the bedroom.
Lori, may I stay for a minute?
Of course. Would you like some coffee or a cocktail?
Oh, honey, I don't want to lose you. Let's call this divorce thing off. Lori, do you hate me so much?
No, Dan, I don't hate you. Right now, I don't know what to think. No, not now.
Jane.
I was passing by and thought I'd ask you to lunch with me tomorrow. Is that a new hairdo, Lori? It's simply stunning.
Yes, I just had it done today. And Dan didn't even notice.
You poor kid. You do love him, don't you?
10 affidavits at $75 each. 4 decrees to deliver. That's $1,000. And that, with our incidental collections, is a total of $1,900. How much have we got in the kitty now?
About $32,000.
Well, we better move on as soon as we hit $35,000. The Stevens case will just do it. What do you think?
I say move on. Our luck's been too good to hold in this town.
All right, we'll leave the end of the week. Oh, by the way, I'm getting the Stevens for another $100 each this afternoon. Want to take care of this?
Mm-hmm.
Hello, Mrs. Stevens. This is Henry Adams. We've just received some news about your case. I wondered if you could stop by the office. Fine. I'll expect you later this afternoon. Goodbye. So you see, Mrs. Stevens, we've jeopardized your entire case if we fail to republish your divorce notice for 2 weeks as the court ordered. It's only an additional $100 and...
I had no idea this would be so costly. And you say I'll have to pay $250 more for the decree?
Well, that's only standard, Mrs. Stevens. If it works a hardship on you, I'm sorry, but what can I do?
Mr. Adams, this $100 I just gave you makes a total of $450. How much has Mrs. Stevens given you?
Oh, I couldn't say offhand. I'd have to check my records, but I think I can say that you're almost off the hook. I mean, you'll have your decree in a few days, and after all, Mrs. Stevens isn't asking for alimony.
And now you want another $250 before you deliver the decree.
Oh, well, that's standard, Mr. Stevens.
How do I know that this divorce will be recognized in this state? It doesn't seem possible that one can get a divorce without either party being present.
Oh. Well, you don't know your Constitution, do you? It guarantees that. It says every state will guarantee full faith and credit to every other state. It's solid, Mr. Stevens, absolutely solid. You haven't got a thing to worry about. Well, I've got to be getting back to my office. Good day, Mr. Stevens.
Good day.
Hello, Lori. I've got to talk to you. Can you meet me in the coffee shop around the corner? Well, it's about this Adams. I think we ought to compare notes. All right, in 20 minutes. It's $400 and my $450 makes $850 we've given Adams.
And we're supposed to shell out 250 more apiece for the decree. Lori, I smelled a rat the minute I met this Adams. I think it's a racket of some kind.
Oh, Dan, it's all my fault. If only I hadn't gone to him.
If only you hadn't gone to anyone. Oh, now, honey, don't cry. We'll work this thing out.
But how? What do we do now?
We'll find a way. In the meantime, let's be thankful we found out we were making a mistake.
And that's the situation, John. Adams expects us in his office at 10 o'clock tomorrow with our money to pick up our decrees.
Obviously, the man is in the confidence game. If he's a lawyer, which I doubt, he's acting unethically. Your decrees won't be worth the paper they're written on, Dan.
We'd just have to remarry if they were good.
But other couples may not be so fortunate. He may have helped to break up a lot of other homes.
What do we do now?
I have an idea, Dan. Suppose you show up at Adams' office tomorrow alone at 10, as you're supposed to. Pretend that everything is okay. I'll have a surprise waiting for him that he won't expect.
All right. I'll leave everything up to you.
Okay, Dan. And now I have some things to do, so...
I sure hope that Lori and I get back together again soon. Thanks a lot, John, and so long.
So long, Dan. And keep your chin up.
Right.
Well, come in, Stevens. Come in. I was just about to telephone you. Sit down, won't you? I have an important appointment away from the office at about 10:30, and I wanted to be sure you hadn't forgotten this was the big day. Your wife intends to show up, doesn't she?
No. No, Mrs. Stevens couldn't come with me. I'll have to take her coffee for her.
Well, you have the money. I mean, her payment and yours.
Oh, yes, I have that here.
Well, in that case, I'm sure that I can give you her copy. Thank you.
Here are the Stevens decrees, Henry. Well,
thank you, Sandra. There you are, sir.
That's fine, Adams, just fine.
What's the meaning of this? Who are you?
I'm Captain Braddock of the Racket Squad. Seal his files, Peters. You're under arrest, Adams. You too, Mrs. Adams, if you're his wife, which I doubt.
You're making a grave mistake, Captain. What are the charges?
Grand theft, bunco, and practicing law without a license.
Oh, that's absurd. Where's your proof?
I have all the proof I need. And your files will undoubtedly furnish more. I checked with the Bar Association, and you're not even an attorney. Yours is a dirty racket, Adams.
No, I wouldn't say that. Some people want a divorce, and I make it easy for them.
You think nothing of destroying the sanctity of marriage, do you? All right, Dan, Lori, you won't be needed here any longer. Oh, by the way, you're not divorced, you know, and this is no place for a second honeymoon. So hustle along home. Oh, we'll want you to testify in court, though.
We'll be there, John, and thanks.
Adams and his accomplice Sandra were cunning and unscrupulous. Their mail order racket had no legal foundations. They were convicted on numerous counts of grand theft, fraud, and practicing law without a license. Don't let what happened to Lori and Dan Stevens happen to you.